My name is Keith Thomas Walker, known as the master of romantic suspense and urban fiction. I'm an award-winning author for my romance novels, my urban novels, as well as my young adult series, the Finley High series. And today I'm going to be sharing a bit of my book with you. This is Election Day. This is a book that my first historical romance. It's not that historical, it was set in the early 70s, but it deals with school integration efforts and a mayoral candidate who wants to change things. So I'll read you the back cover blurb. Despite legal efforts to integrate schools, Black students continue to struggle with separate and unequal environments in 1970. Leo Sullivan, an ambitious mayoral candidate, seeks to close a dark chapter in Overbrook Meadows history, but the opposition is fierce. Falling for his campaign manager was never part of the plan. Leo and Carla must fight for their love, their safety, and the future of their beloved city. So this is a romance novel, and you know, let's just jump into it. One of the deacons was the first to notice something troubling. He notified the pastor, who came to give Leo a heads up. The mood in the cafeteria was loud and joyful. Pastor Warren pulled Leo aside, hoping not to disturb the positive vibes. From across the room, Carla noticed Leo's disposition change as he huddled with the preacher. He looked up and spotted her in the crowd. They locked eyes, and a chill tiptoed down Carla's spine. She broke away from the woman she was speaking to and approached Leo and the pastor. "What's wrong?" "Got some trouble outside," Leo told her. "Pastor Warren says some folks are out there protesting." "Protesting?" Carla frowned. "Protesting here? What are they protesting?" "Deacon Murphy's out there trying to get a better look at their signs," Pastor Warren said, "but he said it got something to do with the schools." Carla shook her head in bewilderment. "What? Why would they be protesting here?" "Seems like they got word about the good work you guys are doing here," Pastor said. "Maybe they're gearing up for what's to come, trying to nip it in the bud before things can go any further." Carla watched Leo's eyes, which had transitioned from confusion to anger. "What are you gonna do?" she asked him. "I'm going out there to see what they want." "I'll go too," Carla said right away. On the way out of the side entrance, they ran into Deacon Murphy. He was a tall man with skin as dark as molasses. "Find out why they're here?" the pastor asked him. "They're protesting your campaign," the deacon said to Leo. "A bunch of hate out there. They don't want those schools integrated." "You talk to them?" Leo asked. "What do they think coming here will solve?" The deacon shook his head. "I didn't talk to them. They're on the property, but not too close to the church. I didn't want to go down there, not by myself." Leo's heart kicked uncomfortably as he stepped outside and was met with bright sunlight, fierce July heat. Ebenezer Baptist was set atop a relatively tall hill. The pastor's home was 50 yards away. The property was enclosed by a ranch-style fence that was only waist high. The closest street was at the bottom of the hill, 100 yards in the distance. The protesters had made their way onto the property, but for some reason decided not to come all the way to the church's parking lot. Their cars were parked alongside the curb. They had encroached upon the sacred grounds by foot. From that distance, Leo couldn't make out much, only that they were all white. They numbered less than 20, and some of them carried signs. He continued walking in their direction with Carla on his left. The pastor and deacon kept up on his right. Upon seeing him, the protesters began to speak among themselves, and then to him directly. Their chant wasn't unified, but Leo got the gist of what they were saying. It wasn't surprising or even new material at this point. They boasted that he'd never become mayor, and white schools were for whites. Leo tried not to let it get to him, but the fact that they would bring their hateful message to the church was infuriating. There were women and children inside, innocent people. He continued to march forward. The crowd did as well. Adrenaline flooded his veins. It collided with the hot summer heat, momentarily making him lightheaded. "I don't want any of the volunteers to see this," he told Carla. "It's not about what you want," she replied gruffly. "It's about what they want. They didn't come here to protest you, Leo. They could have done that at your office. They came to intimidate the people who are helping us because they know we're nothing without them." That observation angered Leo even more. "Stay calm," Carla warned him. "We don't need hotheads on both sides." Leo's group came to a stop in the middle of the field when they were within 25 yards of the protesters. The angry mob did the same. They were close enough to hear their hate speech now and read their signs. Leo's senses were bombarded with the ugly truth of how some in his community viewed him and his people. He was disheartened to see how little progress they'd made since the 60s. A few signs read, Holloway for mayor. Others were more direct, vote no to integration, keep Texas white, and stop the race mixing. The most interesting one read, cursed is the man who integrates, Jeremiah 11:3-6. Pastor Warren must have zeroed in on that one too. He told Leo, how dare they use the word of God to support their hatred? That verse doesn't have anything to do with them, with integration. That's blasphemy what they're doing. He sounded angry, but when Leo looked over at him, the pastor's features were calm. Leo returned his attention to the people of the city he intended to govern. What do y'all want? He asked, his voice loud enough to cut through that rumbling. What have you come here for? We're here to fight for our rights, one of them yelled. Fight for our mayor. We're here to fight for our children, a woman shouted. She was young and attractive, dressed modestly in a knee-length dress. She looked like she could have been a teacher herself. That's fine, Leo told them. Vote for Mayor Holloway all you want. There's no reason for you to be here. This is a free country, one of them shouted. We got a right to be here. This is private property, Pastor Warren countered. This is my property. This is God's house. You ain't got no business over here with that mess, his deacon tacked on. He looked angrier than a junkyard dog. Leo knew Deacon Murphy would protect his pastor at all costs. He prayed he wouldn't do anything to escalate things. Please, Leo said, speaking to the opposition, y'all need to leave. We don't want no trouble. Make us leave, the agitator on the other side yelled. The man was fit in his early 20s. He sported a buzz cut like he was fresh out of boot camp. He appeared to be speaking directly to Deacon Murphy. Holloway for mayor, he yelled, pumping his white fist in the air. Holloway for mayor, Holloway for mayor. His cohorts quickly picked up the chant. Their number was small, but their volume was deafening. Get the hell away from here. That voice was new, and it was one Leo recognized. Cold dread washed over him as he turned and spotted his sister approaching. His eyes grew even larger when he saw she was not alone. His volunteers were pouring out of the church. Many of them toted his newly made campaign signs. His group outnumbered the opposition 7-1, but he didn't want their support at this moment. No, no. He shook his head and met his sister head on. Go back in the church, please. Get these children out of here. Mildred marched past him as if he wasn't even there. You crackers need to get out of here, she yelled. This is a house of God, you heathen. Get the hell away from here. Fuck you, nigger, one of her opponents bellowed. Hey, watch your mouth, Deacon Murphy shouted. Don't disrespect my church like that. Don't disrespect my pastor. Oh, God. The contents of Leo's stomach bubbled. This was the very thing he had hoped to avoid. His group began to hurl more insults as they drew nearer, and the shouting match was in full free fall. With children amongst them, his group was decent enough to be careful of their language, but the flaring tempers were steadily on the rise. Go back inside the church, he pleaded to his ever-growing crowd. We'll take care of this. Please go back inside. He wasn't surprised to hear his campaign manager echo his request. Y'all go back inside, Carla said. She turned and tried to usher them in that direction. We'll take care of this, Pastor Warren yelled over the ruckus. More yelling won't solve anything. Leo turned to corral his sister, who was the first across the neutral space between the groups. It appeared she would march directly into the white faction. Mildred, you need to. He was silenced by a smack to the side of his face that staggered him. Blinded by a bright flash of light and pain, he initially thought he'd been punched. But as his vision cleared, he realized the white group had not moved closer. They're throwing rocks, somebody on his side yelled. Leo focused on the opposition and saw the offender bend to pick up another stone. It was the man with the buzz cut. As Leo watched, he rose to his feet and reached back like a baseball pitcher. With total disregard for the women and children on Leo's side, the man hurled another rock with all his might. So far, he was the only one who had engaged in such recklessness. Still stunned, Leo reached to the source of pain on the side of his head. His nostrils flared when he felt the wetness on the growing contusion. Sure enough, he withdrew his hand and saw his fingers were coated in blood. You son of a bitch, he growled, and headed straight for the man who had harmed him. He didn't make it more than a few feet before someone grabbed his arm. No, Leo, stop. In a split second, it took him to spin angrily and confront the peacemaker. His brain told him who the voice belonged to. His rage did not immediately subside when he stared into Carla's eye. Don't do it, she pleaded. That's what they want you to do. You're going to get some of your people hurt. Her pained expression was matched by the tears in her eyes. Leo almost told her it wasn't him who was trying to hurt people, it was them. They were the ones who had come here looking for trouble. They were the ones throwing rocks. But rationale kicked in, and he knew she was right. Just like the lunch protesters and the freedom riders who had come before him, his cause would crumble if he resorted to the same violence his oppressors used. He didn't want any of his people to be victimized, but for the sake of the movement, he understood that it had to be that way. "They hurt Leo," someone close to him yelled. "He's bleeding. They hurt Leo." The crowd quickly swarmed to confirm this. Okay, so I'm going to stop there with Election Day. The next book, I hope you liked it. If you like Election Day, please go to my website, KeithWalkerBooks.com. Election Day is on sale now. You can find the link to my paperback on my website. And if you want a paperback copy, I'll mail it to you personally. If you want the ebook version, it's on Amazon. And you can either go to my website to find a link or just go to Amazon and type Election Day. Or better yet, just type my name into Amazon, Keith Thomas Walker, to pull you to my full author page. And you can see Election Day and a bunch of more cool stuff Keith Walker related. So the next book I'm going to read an excerpt for is a book that I published previously, but I recently revised it. So technically it's my most recent publication. And this book is called Blow by Blow. And I'm going to read the back excerpt. Oh, it's about a boxer, if you can't tell. So this book has sports, it has romance, it has a little urban, a little violence, you know, blood, women, love. But anyway. Alonzo Ingram takes the boxing world by storm. With the title fight on the horizon, he's poised to give his family the lifestyle they've dreamed about. In the meantime, it's hard to keep a roof over his head, over their heads. Strapped for cash, he goes to work for a notorious crime boss, and trouble soon follows him to the people he loves. Alonzo struggles to hold it together for the biggest fight of his career. When his fiance's first love returns from the war, he realizes his most important battle might not take place in the ring. All right, so without further ado, this is an excerpt from Blow by Blow. All right, so the excerpt I'm reading you is, it's a flashback from when Lonzo and his fiance, Nisha, first met. The year was 2013. Nisha was 19 years old, fresh off a recent breakup with her high school sweetheart, who decided to join the Marines so he could help the world a better place. Nisha was all for tracking down foreign terrorists, but she was deeply in love with Ellis, and his departure hit her hard. After a few months of sulking around the house, Walter finally talked her into going to see a boxing match with him. Her dad was mainly interested in a middleweight named Paco Serrano, but Nisha couldn't help but notice a dark chocolate warrior who entered the ring with only two fights under his belt. Lonzo was ridiculously fine, even back then, and his flashy style and ring dominance was a big turnoff, especially for a boxing fan like Nisha. "Daddy, do you know him?" she asked her father. Lonzo had just won his third fight by first round knockout, but Walter wasn't impressed. "Yeah, I know him. He trains down at the gym with Paco. He's good." Walter noticed her demeanor and shook his head. "He's not all that. He has potential. He could be a good fighter one day, but he's a hothead, as dumb as a post. Got too much street in him. He'll probably do a drive-by when he leaves here tonight. He's no good, baby girl." But unbeknownst to Walter, his discouragement only made Nisha more interested in the young man who had enough balls to call himself the champ, despite not wearing a championship belt. Nisha kept up with her father's comings and goings for the next week. And when Walter returned to the gym, Nisha showed up unexpectedly a few minutes later. Her story was that she couldn't find her cell phone, and maybe she left it in her father's car. Walter didn't buy the ruse. He tried to cut her off when she walked through the door. "Baby girl, what you doing here?" "I can't find my cell phone," Nisha said, looking around the gym. "I was going to ask if you saw it or if I left it in your car." "Why didn't you call to ask me?" Walter wondered. "I just told you, I can't find my cell phone. You could have called from the house phone." "I can't see you coming all the way over here to ask me, Dad." And he looked around. "Who are you looking for?" "Nobody, Daddy. I'm just checking the place out. You act like you don't want me here." "I brought you here plenty of times," Walter said. "I'm just..." "Hey, Walt," one of the trainers wanted help spotting a weightlifter. "Can you give me a hand over here?" Walter turned in that direction. "Hold on, Matt. He almost didn't go. He looked back at Nisha and sighed. I don't have your phone, honey. Okay. Walter waited. So, are you going home? In a minute, she said, looking around. It was the middle of summer, and she was dressed for the occasion in short shorts with a little t-shirt that had the word spoiled sprawled across the chest. She had legs and boobs for days. Half the men in the gym were already peeping her out of the corner of their eyes. Walter shook his head. Nisha, what are you doing? Nothing, Daddy. At that moment, a sound emanated from her purse. Her mouth fell open as she dug for it with a surprised look on her face. Oh, she said, producing her cell phone. Here it is. Walter brought a hand to his face and rubbed his forehead. I'll be right back, he said, and went to help with the weightlifter. Nisha told her friend she'd call her back and went on a prowl. She found her man-to-be sparring with another boxer. She stood innocently next to the ring and called Lonzo's attention right away. The champ had on a tank top with shorts. He looked very nice. Nisha smiled at him and he smiled back. And then Lonzo did something that should have let her know everything her father said about him was true. He turned back to his sparring partner and started to fight him, literally. His partner complained about the hard blows to the body. And when Lonzo hit him in the mouth a couple of times, his friend had had enough. Hey, what the hell are you doing? He asked, rubbing his swollen lip with his glove. What? Lonzo said. What's the problem? Nigga, you hit me. We sparring, Lonzo. Why you hitting me like that? Man, a fight's a fight, Lonzo quipped. He checked to make sure Nisha was still watching. She was. This ain't no fight, you dumbass nigga. Lonzo's face darkened and he went after his friend again. What you say, cuz? What the hell you call me? The other guy hastily got out of the ring. Say, like, leave me alone, Lonzo. Why you starting shit? I'm saying a fight's a goddamn fight, Lonzo spat. Keep your pussy ass out the ring if you can't take it. Lonzo glared at his partner until the man disappeared from sight, and then he turned back to Nisha. He approached her and leaned with his elbows on the rope. What's up, shorty? She shrugged. Nothing. What's up with you, besides the fact that you don't know how to spar? He chuckled. He had a nice smile and beautiful brown eyes. How you figure that? You're not supposed to hit your sparring partner in the face like that, Nisha said, unless you want to spar by yourself from now on. Huh? Lonzo smirked. Like you know something about it. I know a lot about it. What you think? I'm just some hoochie who came in here to see some hot guys. That was pretty close to the truth, but Lonzo didn't know that. My daddy was a fighter. I probably know more about boxing than you. He grinned. Oh yeah, who's your daddy? Nisha liked the way he said that. She had her first sexual fantasy about him right then. Who's your daddy? You, baby. Walter's my daddy, she said. Lonzo's eyes widened. And he straightened his posture. For real? Hey, yo, your pops is the real deal. He a legend. He fought all kind of greats back in the day. I want to be like him when I grow up. Real talk. Except I'm going to be the champion. No disrespect. It's cool, Nisha said. I saw your fight the other day. You're 3-0. You got a long way before you can fight for the title. You saw me fight, Lonzo said and smiled brightly. I wish I would have known that. I wouldn't have hit my sparring partner in the mouth if I knew you already seen me fight. She giggled. So you did that for me? He shrugged. If I was a peacock, I'd show you my feathers, but I ain't got no feathers. I got these. He held up his fist. Nisha liked his analogy, and she could tell he wasn't as dumb as her father said he was. Lonzo was rough around the edges, and he was also confident, strong, and handsome. And the fact that he beat up someone just to get her attention was also a turn-off, even though Nisha knew it shouldn't be. Walter searched for his daughter when he finished helping a trainer, but by then it was too late. When he found Nisha, she was with Lonzo, saving the Roughnecks number in her cell. All right, so that's my excerpt from Blow by Blow. If you like that excerpt, I encourage you to look it up on Amazon, Keith Thomas Walker, Blow by Blow, or you can go to my website, keithwalkerbooks.com, to check out this book or more books from the wonderful land of Overbrook Meadows, Texas. All right, so that's my time for today. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for checking out my interview. Have a nice day.